Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is consideration whether to take items 5 and 6 in private. Item 5 is consideration of evidence we will hear under item 4. And item 6 is the consideration of a draft report on the Scottish Government's Air Quality Improvement Plan. Are we agreed to take these items in private? We are agreed, thank you. The second item on the agenda is consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009, Interim Target Amendment Regulations 2023. I'm pleased to welcome Murray McCallan, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition. I'd also like to welcome from the Scottish Government Norman Munro, a solicitor, and Philip Raines, Deputy Director Domestic Climate Change. Thank you for joining us today. The instrument is laid under an affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve that instrument. And I just remind everyone that officials can speak under this item, but not during in the debate that follows. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you want to make a brief opening statement. Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, thank you very much and good morning, committee. Thank you for having me along to talk about these amendment regulations. This instrument has been drafted following advice from the Committee on Climate Change, of course our statutory advisers, advice from them to modify our emissions targets through the 2020s. These modifications represent a technical adjustment to ensure that targets in the 2020s remain consistent with the latest methodology for carbon accounting. The advice from the Committee on Climate Change was received in December 2022, and this came after a request from Scottish ministers to review our emissions reduction targets. And that request is in line with Section 2C of the 2009 Act, which requires us at least every 5 years to seek advice from the Committee on Climate Change to make sure that our targets are set at the right levels. The CCC's advice highlighted the need to ensure that our targets for 2020s remained aligned with what were significant revisions to international carbon accountings because of a recognition of peatland restoration and its role in reducing emissions. Currently, our targets through the 2020s, these are based on a legislated target of 56%. This is based on advice from we received in 2017, advice that is now outdated and undervalues the role of peatland restoration. Now, these methodological updates, they impact all four countries, but they have a more of an impact in Scotland for two reasons. For example, as compared with our colleagues in England and Wales, we have annual targets, whereas they do so over longer periods of time. And the second reason this has more of an impact on Scotland is because of how central peatland restoration is to our emissions reduction targets. So ultimately, the CCC have recommended that our annual targets from 2021 to 2029, which are set by a straight line from 2020, are adjusted to align with this new international accounting for carbon. And as I say, this instrument responds directly to that. And just as a final point, I would reinforce what the Committee on Climate Change have said themselves, that this is not a lowering of ambition. That 2030 target remains as it previously was. This is just about reflecting better carbon accounting and developments in our understanding of peatland restoration in that period. Of course, our 2045 target remains unchanged as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Just looking around to see if there's any questions. Mark, if you'd like to start, please.
Thanks very much for that. So I suppose this has come about because of a greater understanding of what's happening in the natural world and how that greenhouse gas inventory is changing over time. I'm just wondering if you anticipate any other changes coming in later years, because I know that our understanding of blue carbon, for example, is increasing, although that's currently outside of the inventory. We don't really account for that. So I'm just wondering, could this be a game changer in terms of understanding more about the science and whether that might impact further down the line? If there's any sense of that in terms of the international debate within the science community.
Yes, thank you for the question. I suppose in all aspects of our journey to net zero, I expect change and I expect development. I expect that in the way we account for emissions, particularly in the natural world, and you're absolutely right to highlight blue carbon. It's often put to me that where we were 5 years ago with our understanding of peatland emissions, we are now at that point with blue carbon, and I do expect advances in that. I also expect advances in technology, and you know, everything that we do has to be iterative because of that. I suppose just to round off my answer, I would say that we are statutorily bound to seek the committees on climate change advice on these changes. We have to do that at least every 5 years. We will continue to do that following the legislation, and therefore I do expect that there will be adjustments to be made as we move through our annual targets. Hmm.
I suppose the flip side of that, though, is that if blue carbon was brought in, it may affect the targets, but it may also bring in solutions such as blue carbon, marine protected areas, or seagrass or kelp restoration, and you know, it might open up opportunities for progress, as well as having to account for an entirely new part of our biosphere in terms of our thinking with the inventory.
Yes, absolutely. And I want to see the science on blue carbon developing. That's partly why we're funding research in our academic institutions and supporting projects like Project Seagrass, so as to develop what I think we would all agree is going to be a very important part of our carbon accounting and our journey to net zero, but with science that is just a little behind where we are in the terrestrial space. So yes, absolutely, very behind that, and I think it will be a useful addition once we get to a settled position on it.
Thanks very much. No further questions.
Mark. Liam.
Good morning. This is, as you've said, Cabinet Secretary, all about targets and not lowering the ambition. But the CCC that you mentioned also highlighted that, and there's a quote here, key milestones are ambitious, but a clear delivery plan on how they'll be achieved is still missing, and there is no quantification of how policies combine to give the emissions reduction required to meet Scotland's targets. So, Cabinet Secretary, what work has been done to address those concerns of the Climate Change Committee and ensure that even though previous targets may have been missed, these new ones might actually be achieved?
Well, I think, you know, overall, I first of all obviously take the advice from the Committee on Climate Change very seriously, and their remarks in recent years, months have been, I would say, constructively critical about the pathway. My overall view is that we are making good progress. We are more than halfway to net zero, but I am equally sure that the next phase of emissions reduction, particularly out to 2030, will be some of the most challenging parts of our journey that we have to go through. So what are we doing to respond to that? Well, we will officially respond to the Committee on Climate Change most recent advice in due course. Also later this year, we will lay a draft of the next full statutory climate change plan, which will look across the piece on Scotland's economy and society and demonstrate how emissions reduction will be achieved against their sector envelopes right across our economy. And of course, so it will set that emissions pathway for each sector, and it will also include details of the costs and the benefits of the policies it contains. So that full statutory plan, a draft of which will be laid in November.
And on that, the current climate change plan, it commits to reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030. The Climate Change Committee are saying that the current plans lack a full strategy with sufficient levers to deter car use. So given that that's, we've now known about that for a while, the CCC have said that for a while, what measures has the government been looking at to meet that specific target and reduce transport-related emissions?
I think for the purposes of today, I would say, because a lot of this work is still under development, I would point to the fact that we will be responding precisely to that point in the Committee on Climate Change advice very soon, and that will be built into our climate change plan, the draft of which will be laid in November. So rather than today going into some of the detail of what my officials and I are developing, I would rather wait till we get to the point of publishing the response, and I'll be more than happy to discuss some of that with the committee.
Now, final question then.
Generous in the sense that this instrument's about amending the targets, and I know you want to look at how those targets are going to be achieved. So I would allow one more question, and then I think, in fairness, there are other people that want to come in, if I may.
So when will that be published, Cabinet Secretary?
In due course.
This year?
The response, absolutely, yes. So it will come in advance of the climate change plan draft, and the draft will be laid in November.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liam. And yes, the Deputy Convener is going to come in, Fiona.
So part of the strength, but also the challenge of the targets that we have had is because they were met as a cross-party commitment by the government. The government was actually pushed to have tougher targets and annual targets. So looking at how you translate the revised targets into the delivery plan for the climate change plan that's going to be produced or laid, as you said, at the end of November, how are you going to keep that cross-party support that was important to set the ambitious targets in the first place, which you say have been kept for 2030 and 2045, if not the trajectory changing somewhat?
Yes, absolutely. And I suppose I would just reiterate that point, that even though I'm here today talking about these annual changes, I think for myself and for my colleagues, our view of the challenge hasn't changed whatsoever, because we're still very much planning out to 2030 and very much out to 2045. But you're absolutely right. These very, very stretching commitments, particularly the 2030 75%, were set on a cross-party basis across the Parliament. And I am very keen to foster cross-party working as we agree how we're going to respond to them. And one of the ways that we are doing that is through a cross-party, cross-civic society group looking at the development of the climate change plan. It was formerly chaired by Michael Matheson, and I'll take over that now in this role, bringing together stakeholders, bringing together MSPs from across the chamber as we discuss key points of response to the climate change issues. And I'll continue that right up to the point where we're publishing the draft. And then, of course, it will be with Parliament to consider and to scrutinise.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's all the questions. So we'll move on to agenda item 3. This is the formal consideration of the motion calling for the committee to recommend approval of these climate change regulations. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move the motion.
Thanks, Convener. I would just commend the SSI to the committee as a necessary step in maintaining Scotland's the credibility of our emissions accounting framework, and I move the motion.
Okay, and there's now the opportunity for members to make any contributions, if subject to anything they've made earlier. No? So, Cabinet Secretary, you are technically allowed to sum up. I'm not sure there's much you'd like to say, but I'm happy for you to do so if you want to.
I'll just waive that, Convener. I've said all I wanted to. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So the question that we come to is motion S6M08482 in the name of Murray McCallum be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I'd like to invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are you all happy?
Yes.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you and your officials. And I'm now going to suspend the meeting to prepare for the next item. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Our next item of business is an evidence session as part of our inquiry into Scotland's electricity infrastructure, inhibitor or enabler of our energy ambitions. Today we will conclude our inquiry by hearing from the Scottish Government to understand its vision for electricity infrastructure as set out in the draft energy strategy. We will also explore different themes that have emerged during our inquiry. I'm pleased to welcome Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy. Thank you for accepting our invitation and congratulations on your new role. I'd also like to welcome from the Scottish Government Claire Jones, the Head of Onshore Electricity Policy, and Raggy Lowe, the Deputy Director for Onshore Electricity Policy. Thank you for joining us today. And before we begin, I believe, Cabinet Secretary, you wish to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. I really appreciate the opportunity to be before you today so early in my new role and for the work, and appreciate the work that the committee is doing to investigate what's a really important area of policy. The Scottish Government's draft energy strategy and just transition plan sets out the actions needed to transform our energy system to reach net zero whilst delivering maximum benefit for Scotland. We must take the right decisions now to capitalise on the enormous opportunities that this transition offers our economy, our citizens and our climate. We are fortunate to benefit from vast renewable energy resources, including significant offshore wind potential, substantial tidal energy resources and a well-developed onshore wind sector as well. Increasing levels of homegrown renewable supply will make energy more affordable, and in combination with technologies like hydrogen, batteries and pumped storage hydro, we can ensure that power is available when we need it. Scotland has the potential to be a powerhouse for renewable energy, electricity and green hydrogen to meet our domestic needs, and for Europe exporting clean electricity as part of an integrated system with the rest of Europe and supporting decarbonisation of industry across the continent. The significant increase in installed capacity of renewable generation over the coming decade could mean Scotland's annual electricity generation is more than double Scotland's electricity demand by 2030 and more than treble by 2045. This will enable Scotland to meet a large proportion of our demand through renewables alone, while still creating an export opportunity for our surplus. As the energy transition progresses, we will all see changes in the way that we use our energy resources. We will reduce heat demand by improving the energy efficiency of our homes and non-domestic buildings and decarbonise transport. This will come with significant co-benefits for people and society, including improvements in health and well-being, contributing positively to a just transition. Realising this positive vision for our future, however, rests on the delivery of more energy infrastructure. Significant investment in Scotland's and the wider Great Britain electricity grid is needed to ensure clean, cheap, renewable electricity can flow to where it is needed. Electricity transmission infrastructure in particular requires huge levels of investment to ensure the grid does not become a barrier to net zero. In this context, it's important to acknowledge that we are part of the GB electricity system, and the powers in respect to that system are reserved to the UK Government. We must therefore work together to enable these critical investments, ensuring that all regulatory and policy levers, both reserved and devolved, are used to ensure full grid decarbonisation, drive down costs and increase benefits for customers and communities. The Scottish Government has called for a more agile approach to network regulation for many years. The energy regulator's recent approval of local network business plans for the next 5 years and the decision to accelerate the delivery of strategic transmission investment are positive steps in that direction. The ambitious programme of infrastructure investment required to meet our net zero and interim targets relies on a high degree of confidence in the market. We are therefore clear that the UK Government's plans to redesign our electricity market through its review of electricity market arrangement, REMA, must be conducted with sufficient lead time, protecting investor confidence and ensuring that the critical infrastructure and investment needed today to protect consumers and keep us on the pathway to net zero is not delayed. That is why we are continuing to call for urgent reform to the grid connection, queue management and transmission charging regimes, all of which could lead to transformational change in much quicker time. We agree that the time taken to consent grid infrastructure projects needs to be accelerated, while still ensuring robust and balanced decision-making. However, whilst the National Energy Infrastructure Planning has been reformed in England and Wales, which set out a modern consenting regime, the equivalent in Scotland has not taken place, as legislative competence for the energy consenting regime remains reserved to the UK Government, with the Scottish Parliament unable to legislate for the required reform like elsewhere in the UK. The Scottish Government has proposed solutions to the UK Government that would enable the changes required, and we continue to call on the UK Government to urgently find a legislative solution. Finally, Convener, let me thank the Committee for your work on this important issue. I look forward to the report, which will provide crucial advice in the preparation of our final energy strategy and just transition plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And before we go into the meeting, I'd just like to remind members and the audience who are listening that as a farmer and a landowner, I have electricity transmission lines across my farm in the form of 11 kV lines, 33 kV ring main lines, and I'm in negotiation for a 132 kV line to go through the farm. All of those will generate some income at some stage for the farm. I don't want there to be any doubt that I have some interest in these power lines, and I will continue to make this declaration as and when I believe it's appropriate to do so. But I do not believe, having made that declaration, it prevents from me from doing my job as convener of this committee. So I want to everyone to know that, and I'm delighted, Cabinet Secretary, that you've made the point at the outset, which I was going to make at the end, that you'll be using the report from this inquiry to inform decisions that you make. The committee does feel it's a very important inquiry as far as the future for energy in Scotland. So I'm going to come first to the Deputy Convener, who's got some questions for you. Fiona.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us, Cabinet Secretary. I want to focus on contract for difference options. Do you support the proposed use of multi-factor contract for difference options, and what other means are available for promoting a sustainable Scottish supply chain for wind energy?
So contract for difference has made a difference. I think it's important to stress that. However, we would be looking for contract for difference to go further. For instance, in the space of marine energy, we know that the sector was looking for £70 million worth of investment, £20 million came forward. It's making a difference. We can see that in terms of the projects that are coming through, but we want to see contract for difference go much further than what it is at the moment.
And clearly, inward investment is very welcome, but how do we ensure a Scottish supply chain for industrial manufacturing?
So we've got good news on that front recently. I was in Japan to meet with the board of Sumitomo, who are coming forward with a large-scale inward investment project, building a factory that will see the production of high-voltage cable for the offshore renewables industry in Scotland. But that is the first, and I hope will be a long line of inward investment opportunities that will see much better domestic production of for the supply chain of particularly the offshore wind industry. We want to make sure that we are able to see jobs growth here in Scotland, but also that we're able to see a well-serviced supply chain that allows the opportunities that we have in renewables to come through.
Can I maybe ask you to focus on what I asked, which was in relation to a Scottish supply chain? Certainly, inward investment is very welcome, including the Japanese announcement you've just made. But are you suggesting that the only opportunity will be on servicing and not on manufacturing for Scottish industry?
No, absolutely not. The Sumitomo announcement, for instance, is for manufacturing. They're going to be manufacturing the cable that is going to bring forward to ensure that the offshore wind industry is supplied with the cable that's required. required. There's a worldwide shortage of high voltage cable, and so the fact that Sumitomo have chosen to put a factory here in Scotland is going to be very important to that. But I hope that that also brings confidence to other investors, both domestic and international, to be able to base their operations here. We are a world leader when it comes to offshore renewables. That fact was made very plain to me when I was in Japan, and there are huge opportunities, but we need to make sure that we are giving confidence to investors, both domestic and international, and that comes through the work that you're doing in the committee here today and the report that you're going to be coming forward with around ensuring that there is going to be sufficient capacity to be able to respond to the generation demand that is going to be coming through from our offshore potential.
And can I ask, what are the potential impacts of changes to the CFD auction system, both, I think, in rules and operation, for example, in relation to price or achieving net zero? Previously, the previous Cabinet Secretary for Energy and also the previous Cabinet Secretary for Environment were very keen on pursuing achieving net zero, but there may have been an argument to say that price should have ruled out instead. So what are your views on changes to the CFD auction system?
I'll bring in Claire at this stage.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. So I think you may be aware that the UK Government are currently consulting on introducing non-price factors to the CFD regime. So looking at what are the other things that the regime itself can actually value beyond just cost. And I think that's, the UK Government have stated that that's partly in recognition that using drivers solely on cost means that there is the risk that the supply chain opportunities that could, excuse me, could come out of this could perhaps be lost. So they're currently consulting on that at the moment. One of the key things that we'd like to see is to understand how that would affect supply chain plans, which are currently part of projects that are worth more than 300 megawatts, so particularly for offshore wind, and get more detail from the UK government on which non-price factors are going to actually be in play and how much credit will be given to each of those factors. And I think those are details that are still needing to come out from the UK government.
And finally for me, I'd like to ask your views on how the market should be designed or what market mechanisms should be used to encourage the deployment of hydrogen electrolysers and particularly, again, Scottish-based manufacturing of such electrolysers.
So thank you, Deputy Convener. The opportunities that we have, again, to be a first to market and a world leader on particularly green hydrogen and using hydrogen electrolysers is vast. We have a major opportunity here. What's going to be important there is the fact that we are going to be producing a significant amount more offshore wind generation than we're actually going to be able to utilise, particularly if the grid capacity doesn't come up to speed. So we're going to need to ensure that we are responding with the hydrogen opportunity through that. So our Hydrogen Action Plan gives a target for 5 gigawatts of hydrogen capacity by 2030. I would imagine there's going to be a mix in terms of what we are using the hydrogen for, both the localised usage but also feeding into the grid and potential for export as well. But it's going to be an important factor for us to ensure that we're able to utilise the renewables potential that we have, the significant over provision that we will have of renewables at renewable electricity. Some of that is going to need to be used through hydrogen, and we need to make sure that we continue to be a world leader in terms of the opportunities that's coming through from that.
So you talk about the opportunity for production. I'm interested particularly in the manufacture of hydrogen electrolysers in Scotland. Mm. So what are the enterprise agencies doing, or are other public bodies or publicly funded bodies doing to support hydrogen electrolysers being manufactured here in Scotland?
So we're working with enterprise agencies to ensure that we have a good supply chain, both in terms of the manufacture of items that are going to be needed and the components that are going to be needed going forward, but also to ensure that they're supporting business opportunities, both domestic and inward investment, to ensure that we are well servicing the potential that we have, and I'll make sure that we write to the committee with further information around that work that's been done with the enterprise agencies.
Thank you. Come here.
Okay, Mark, you wanted to come in briefly on this.
Yeah, just on supply chain, I suppose one bit of feedback I've heard from parts of the renewable energy industry is that, you know, while there are really strong targets in the energy strategy, just transition plan, you know, there's strong ambition there. Perhaps what isn't there in there at the moment is a clear sort of pathway towards development of the supply chain, a clear kind of focus on which bits of the supply chain we want to develop going forward. Is that something that could come on the back of the energy strategy, just transition plan, or is it something that you're looking at changing perhaps in you know, as a result of the consultation and feedback? I'm just trying to work out where that actually sits, that kind of market and supply chain development, because the Japanese announcement is incredibly welcome, but where does that kind of sit within a wider kind of plan for a supply chain for offshore?
So we've established a new offshore wind directorate within the Scottish Government to look directly at this, partly to learn from the process that was involved in the onshore wind sector, and to ensure that we have a supply chain that, as much as possible, to continue to respond to the Deputy Convener's questions, sees a domestic supply chain as part of that. So the Sumitomo announcement is important because I think that gives confidence to other potential investors. It also gives confidence to the potential that Scotland has as a renewable energy generator. Obviously, the energy strategy and just transition plan will be important in terms of ensuring that we continue to put the policy levers in place that allow for the domestic supply chain to be put in place and to ensure that we're able to service the demands of the sector offshore.
Just on onshore wind as well, we published our final onshore wind policy statement at the tail end of last year, committing to a new ambition of an additional 12 gigawatts of onshore wind by 2030. And as part of that process, we understand that we need to talk to industry about the things that we need in order to get us there. So we've set up the Onshore Wind Strategic Leadership Group, which is looking to work with industry experts across the piece to develop a sector deal, which will be later this year. And that sector deal is going to look at things like supply chain, you know, things that could be barriers to the deployment of onshore wind. But really key in that is having that really in-depth conversation with industry to understand what are the barriers here and how can Scottish Government help to remove those barriers so that we can get to that deployment ambition.
Yeah, Raggy.
Yeah, sorry, I'll just come in as well. Just on the finalisation of the energy strategy and just transition plan, the consultation closes today. So we'll be taking stock of the many hundreds of responses that we've received and a lot of the engagement we've been doing with stakeholders. And as you suggest, a lot of that has been around the delivery side. What does a delivery plan look like for the strategy and on the supply chain side? So I think you can expect that the final strategy will have a stronger kind of pathway through that supply chain and delivery, those issues.
Thanks.
Just before we leave this, Cabinet Secretary, there's been some discussion that the options for ScotWind didn't produce as much income as they might have done on the basis that more emphasis was put on the supply chain benefits of it. Can you just try and quantify that or dispel that rumour before we move on?
So, first of all, the negotiations around the leasing round were obviously conducted by Crown Estate Scotland. However, the Scottish public purse is set to receive a significant amount of revenue over the course of ScotWind. First of all, £750 million in terms of initial leasing options. The supply chain is important. That has the potential to raise £28 billion worth of revenue through the supply chain work, and there will be ongoing rental costs as well, which could factor into multiple billions of pounds coming back into Scottish public purse. So a significant opportunity has been realised through ScotWind. But obviously, you know, I'm sure both Crown Estate Scotland and government colleagues will be learning from that initial process and further leasing rounds.
And I look forward to the opportunity to discuss whether it's income or capital for Crown Estates, and whether the money should remain within the Crown Estates will come into the Scottish purse, which is a conversation I've had with your predecessor. The next question come from Ash Regan. Ash.
Good morning to the panel. The committee has heard that the use of targets sends that signal to the regulator, and that allows for that forward planning for infrastructure particularly. So can you explain why targets haven't been set for either solar or tidal?
So we're looking, as part of the discussions that we're having around the energy strategy and just transition plan, whether we should have targets for solar and tidal, and considering with the sector, if we were to set that, what the target would look like. And we, as we continue to consider that, we'll obviously keep the committee updated on our decisions in that regard.
So what do you see as the main either benefits or downsides in using targets to kind of drive the progress there?
Well, clearly, targets do drive investment and drive progress. On solar, we've obviously got a very strong industry in place already. There is a large amount, particularly of domestic solar production. Tidal is moving forward at a pace. One of the first visits that I had was with the First Minister to Nova Innovation in Leith, which is producing the domestic, with domestic production, producing tidal generators that are currently being deployed in Shetland, and they're looking at the opportunity of deployment elsewhere around the world. So we have a huge opportunity there again for tidal and other marine production, and as I say, we will continue to consider whether or not targets for those two sectors would be appropriate and whether that would help to ensure we continue to drive the growth of those sectors.
Yes, as you rightly say, tidal seems to be very promising, and obviously we've got some very high levels of innovation on that particular technology in Scotland, which is obviously exciting to see that. Solar in particular as well seems to be quite complementary to wind. I understand that that can often be co-located where the wind turbines are, and that, you know, in terms of weather, it could often be generating perhaps when it isn't windy. So it seems that these do have a place in the future. In this strategy, they don't seem to be receiving as much attention, either of those two technologies. So do you think that they will play a significant role in Scotland's electricity system going forward, or do you think it's too early at the moment?
Absolutely. I think they will have a central role to play. And again, going back to that visit that I had at Nova Innovation, they were looking at the potential for innovation in the technology of floating solar, which they see as being a potentially landmark breakthrough moment for both for Scotland and our capacity, our generation capacity, and Ms Regan rightly speaks of the complementarity that there is potentially there, but also in other markets where that technology can be exported, and they're looking particularly at the Middle East. So there are huge opportunities there. It absolutely will be part of our energy mix, and I'm very excited, as somebody hailing from Orkney, where some of these technologies are being tested, to be seeing that coming through so strongly.
Thank you, Convener.
Liam, you've got some follow-ups on that, I think.
Just one, please. Just on the solar energy point, Cabinet Secretary. So this committee heard from Solar Energy UK, I think they were called, that they wanted a 6-gigawatt target, I believe, for solar energy, and that would be really important and potentially game-changing. I hear what you say about the energy strategy, but you're the Cabinet Secretary. What's your view? Should that target be put in place?
So I read the submission that came from Solar Energy UK, and you know, I'm very sympathetic to that, and it's something that we are actively considering. I don't want to preempt the process that's ongoing at the moment in terms of whether or not a target would be appropriate, but suffice to say we have heard the submission from the industry, and we'll certainly consider that going forward.
Convener.
Thank you, Liam. The next questions come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning and welcome. If you don't mind, I'd like to talk about hydropower or ask you questions about hydropower. I'd like to know what the appropriate market mechanisms are for hydro, and how could these support some of the small-scale run-of-river and the large-scale pump storage?
So hydropower has a huge potential, again, to ensure that there is consistent supply of renewable energy into the system. There is more work to be done there to ensure that the grid capacity is able to cope with that, and that the consenting regime is appropriate to ensure that that these projects are getting off the ground quickly enough. We have a large potential, particularly for pumped hydro storage, and would hope that the UK government will listen to the requests that have been made around ensuring that the process can be as smooth as possible going forward.
Okay. And in regards to the UK government, what discussions have you had with them regarding the hydro? Also, you were talking about the grid capacity. I mean, I've been speaking to some small-scale folk who are saying that it's difficult for them to get onto the grid because they're just not producing enough, but there's a lots of little ones that we could actually be benefiting from.
The Energy Minister, Julie Martin, met with Andrew Bowie the day that Mr Bowie gave evidence to this committee on the UK Government's new energy bill, and some of the discussions featured the issue around capacity within the grid and ensuring that there was appropriate support in place to allow projects such as these to come on board. I'll bring in Claire to provide supplementary information.
So I think going back to your first part of the question, Ms Dubar, which was on the UK government and talking to them about hydro support mechanisms. So we're in regular contact with UK government officials to discuss what we think long duration energy storage, including hydro, needs in terms for it to be deployable. They launched a consultation last year, and we understand a response to that will be forthcoming shortly. But the Scottish Government has been very clear that in order for hydro to be able to play the really vital role that we think it's going to play in the energy system, it needs a proper support mechanism. And so we're waiting on that and calling for the UK Government to take that role. In terms of grid capacity, quite difficult without understanding exactly where you're talking about, because the conditions in terms of how much headroom is in the grid can vary in a very short distance, in a very short geography. But the way the network is built, and without wishing to get too technical about this, I'll try to remain not too technical. The network is built in a way that you don't want to have huge amounts of headroom in the network everywhere, because if you do, then the cost of paying for that network can fall back to consumers. So the networks run quite tightly. And obviously, as we see more and more renewable energy projects coming on board, that headroom is kind of being eaten up. Mm-hmm. And you'll get to a point where in a particular area, there's no available headroom without significant investment in the network. And obviously, the regulator Ofgem has to be very careful in terms of how much investment to enable because of that primary duty towards protection of consumers and making sure that consumers aren't paying for massive bits of network that no one is using.
I spoke a couple of months ago to someone in regards to the small scale ones, and they were saying that they were finding it difficult. Because they're not producing the capacity that is required, that they're being overlooked. And that's what I was kind of asking, if there's any way to get these guys on board. The name escapes me just now, but I can pass it on to you later if that's helpful.
I think that would be useful, yes, thank you.
Just to add, we have regular conversations with both the transmission operators and the distribution network operators. And we have a group that's looking at connection for customers, both demand-side customers, so people needing electricity, and also people producing electricity. So if we could take some details, that'd be great. We can feed that into that process.
I'll have a look back just now, convener, in my diary to see if the name pops up, and I'll come back later on.
Jackie, can I leave it to you to inform the Cabinet Secretary's office, and if you think it's relevant as a committee issue, to keep the committee informed, and if it's more relevant as a constituency issue, that you do that. But the balance is for you. Just before we leave Hydro, Cabinet Secretary, if I may, is... Sorry, Jackie, I assume you finished.
Yes, yes,
is there's some great examples, I think, of where water is used more than once to generate electricity. The Tummel scheme, I think, where it goes through five particular dams to generate electricity, which has got to be a good example. Perhaps a bad example may be the water going down to Loch Arbour, which goes through one generation scheme, but comes from three different catchments, one of the ones I live in fact, the Spey. So how is the Scottish Government going to encourage a more holistic approach and more use of water which is being stored to generate as much electricity as possible?
So I think the pump storage capacity is going to be really important for giving that consistent energy supply from renewables that we're looking for, particularly as we look to replace the fossil fuel baseload that is provided. So obviously we'll be looking to make sure that that is done in a holistic way that ensures that it is done most efficiently and that is done taking communities with us as well in on that journey. So we'll be making sure we can keep those under consideration.
I'll watch carefully, Cabinet Secretary. But the next questions come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks. So I wanted to go back to hydrogen and to try and just explore with you, Cabinet Secretary, the government's vision for hydrogen. So we do have targets in the energy strategy, 5 gigawatts of hydrogen by 2030, 25 gigawatts by 2045. I just want to get a sense from yourself about where you see that generation coming from and the mix of blue hydrogen versus green hydrogen, or maybe as a transition to green hydrogen. So maybe with the five gigawatts capacity, where we see that coming from and how that can shift over time.
So the importance of blue hydrogen is obviously carbon capture and storage is going to be incredibly important for any blue hydrogen coming forward. And again, I would encourage the UK government to move as fast as possible in confirming the ACORN Track 2 status to ensure that that project can go forward. But really the aspiration has got to be around maximising the opportunity from green hydrogen. And I think that's where ScotWind gives us a huge opportunity. If we can ensure that some of the over provision that we're likely to get from ScotWind projects is linked to green hydrogen projects, then we have a huge opportunity to, similar with pump storage, to ensure that we have ongoing energy security when there are dips in supply from other areas.
Mm-hmm. So I guess the blue would come from Grangemouth, maybe on-site generation at Moss Murrin as well. But beyond that, beyond ACORN, beyond what's part of that cluster, we're really looking at green going forward.
I think that's got to be the overall aspiration. I think where there is complementarity that allows for blue hydrogen, I don't see where that would come beyond Grangemouth, but depends on the potential projects coming forward. But green hydrogen is really where the maximum opportunity is and where the big wins will come, in my view.
Okay, so what about the infrastructure that we need to develop that? I mean, there's some big figures in there. It's a very nascent technology. We don't really have much in the way of infrastructure at the moment. So what do you see as the infrastructure we need to put in place between now and 2030?
So we'll need infrastructure near to where the offshore renewables is coming from. We've put forward a £100 million fund to see that transition go forward and to hopefully encourage further investment to ensure that the technology can become commercialised and to see further infrastructure come through off the back of that. We're looking to work with potential producers to ensure that their plans align with where we are looking to go, and I'm hopeful of that coming forward.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of developing that, sorry, was that? Yeah, okay. In terms of just developing that vision for hydrogen and the hydrogen industry going forward. And I'm interested to know where that work is now with stakeholders. I mean, it's quite clear to me in the energy strategy that there's a, you know, a kind of prioritisation of the use of hydrogen. There's like a hydrogen ladder. So my reading of it is that, you know, the future is going to be less about using hydrogen to heat your shower in the morning, but much more about decarbonising hard-to-abate sectors in industry. But I'm just wondering kind of how you then, on the back of the energy strategy, developing that vision, that stakeholder vision for what the hydrogen economy looks like in 2030 and 2045.
So we'll continue to work with stakeholders to develop that. I think you're right. The use of hydrogen is going to be a mix. It's going to be about decarbonising, you know, hard-to-abate sectors, you know, transport, for example. It'll also has the potential to supplement the gas grid and to see some of that hydrogen go into the gas grid, and also for export. I mean, I think it's going to be a combination of all of that. But you know, the technology required for all of those areas are, as you say, nascent. So we are looking to support its production and commercialisation through the £100 million fund that we've got coming forward, and we hope that there are going to be some announcements through that very shortly, so that we can see a real path for the future of hydrogen and how we can meet our targets for 2030 and 2045.
Okay. And then just moving on then to Acorn and the CCS cluster. I mean, again, I think there's a recognition in the Energy Strategy Just Transition Plan that it is needed, particularly for those hard-to-abate sectors. It's not really clear that there's any other pathway to decarbonise those sectors. But, you know, there are still risks and uncertainties around the deployment of the technology, not least the, you know, the Track 2, you know, process. So, like, what do we sort of do if we don't have Acorn? Is there an alternative pathway in terms of energy? Are there other technologies, other avenues that could be explored, or all the eggs in one basket?
It's very, very challenging to see an alternative. I think Acorn, I think carbon capture is absolutely critical. And, you know, the Acorn project is the most advanced, it is the most secure, has the ability to get up and running incredibly quickly, and we'll see a massive decarbonisation of our largest carbon emitter at Grangemouth, and so I would again encourage the UK government to come forward as quickly as possible, as I heard the committee do when Mr Bowie was before the committee a couple of weeks ago. It is really important for not just Scotland's net zero ambitions, but if the UK is serious about its net zero ambitions, that carbon capture at Acorn continues to be progressed and progressed quickly.
Okay. And then just in terms of funding then, there's been, you know, discussion in the Chamber about Scottish Government's contribution, particularly over the Emerging Energy Technologies Fund. Can you just provide some clarity as to what the funding might look like for CCUS and how it relates to the UK Government's commitment?
Raggy?
So we've provided, as you know, funding through the Transition Fund, funding for the Global Underwater Hub, and also funding through the Just Transition Fund for a number of projects, including the Skills Passport and so on. So there's a range of different funding streams that have gone in to support. There's also a commitment on CCS, and that remains in play, and in seeking the UK government to take action on Track 2 so that we can accelerate that funding investment.
Mm-hmm. But can you just give a picture about who will fund it? I mean, how will it be funded, and the relative contributions of industry, government within that? Is there clarity on that?
I'll need to come back to the committee with more detail on that.
Yeah, that'll be useful. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Liam, I think you've got some questions.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning again. Sticking with the energy strategy, Cabinet Secretary, you've inherited a draft energy strategy which sets a presumption against North Sea oil and gas. And Ragnar Lowe conceded earlier on that there's no delivery plan underlying that at the moment, either for how to deliver that or for to mitigate the consequences of that decision. The context of this is a report out today which shows an overwhelming majority of people think that the UK should meet its oil and gas demand from domestic production rather than importing it. So, Cabinet Secretary, what's your view? Do you think that there should be no new exploration and production in the North Sea?
So, first of all, the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan is for consultation. So, we're currently consulting on the language that Mr Kerr has outlined, and the finalised plan will reflect the consultation responses that we've received. So, I'm not sure if Mr Kerr himself has responded to that with his views on the language that he's outlined around presumption against, but I'm sure others will have, and we will absolutely continue to consider whether that is appropriate. Obviously, consenting for oil and gas is reserved to the UK government. It is not a decision for the Scottish Government to take. We believe that maximum extraction of oil and gas is not compatible with our net zero objectives, but we're also cognizant of the fact that we're not able to turn off our requirement for the use of oil and gas overnight, and so we need to take a pragmatic approach that meets our demand. So that is going to be requiring the UK government to have a much stronger climate compatibility measure and ensure that any decisions that they take are within those climate compatibility measures.
I'll just press you, Cabinet Secretary. You are the Cabinet Secretary. What is your view? You haven't, Cabinet Secretary. I asked for your view on whether there should be no new exploration and production in the North Sea. As the new Cabinet Secretary, the committee would be interested in where you intend to take the portfolio.
I've set out my view because this is not an area that I have responsibility for. Mr Kerr will be aware that the decisions around consents for new oil and gas exploration rest with the UK government. Now, I don't think that is something that, in fact, I check back the record, I'm pretty sure that is not something that Mr Kerr asked Mr Bowie, who actually has a direct responsibility for this, a couple of weeks ago. My view is, as I've set out, that maximum extraction of oil and gas is not going to be compatible with our net zero objectives. We need to take a pragmatic approach, recognising the fact that there is still going to be a demand for oil and gas to meet our ongoing energy security going forward, but we need a much faster just transition, which includes the UK government investing in areas like carbon capture and storage and the grid capacity to allow us to take advantage of our massive renewables potential. And I hope that the UK government will come forward with a much stronger climate compatibility test to ensure that any new oil and gas coming forward meets net zero objectives.
I had understood that energy was part of your portfolio, Cabinet Secretary, which is why I'll ask you, you've inherited a strategy which will refuse to countenance new nuclear energy because the Scottish Government has said it will use the planning system, which it does have power over, to ensure that that doesn't happen. Again, Cabinet Secretary, what is your view? And if the Scottish Government intends to continue with a presumption against new nuclear generation, why?
Because we believe that it is an expensive technology, and the safety and environmental impacts that come off the back of it. We think that there are huge opportunities coming forward for us in our renewables capability. It gives us cheaper electricity than what is coming forward from the new nuclear power stations that have been funded to a very costly extent by the UK government, and rest with the fact that our future energy security will come from renewables.
Well, on that exact point, currently oil and gas and nuclear provide a constant baseload and a significant amount of it. From where will that baseload come once Torness closes and once you've wound down the North Sea, and when will your renewables be in a position to take up?
So obviously the energy, the baseload requirements and ensuring that there is energy security to supply the grid is the responsibility of the ESO, as Mr Kerr will be aware. But we're confident that the potential that we have for renewables we've been discussing this morning in terms of not just onshore but offshore wind, our pumped hydro storage capabilities, our green hydrogen capabilities, the tidal renewable opportunities that are coming forward. The tide goes in and out twice a day and gives very clear and certain energy capacity going forward. We have a huge opportunity to meet the demand that will be coming from Scotland's consumers.
But you talked about potential. So, Cabinet Secretary, ask again, when will that potential be realised such that the renewables you've discussed take over the production of baseload?
So we've I've already set out in my introduction the opportunity that the renewables production will give us by 2030 and 2045, doubling and trebling the demand that is currently being brought forward from Scottish consumers.
Convener.
Thank you, Liam. I think, Monica, you wanted to come in with a supplementary on that.
I did. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. I just wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary, given a decision is imminent from the UK Government, the Scottish Government has been asked by many campaigners to use its Dove power and its platform to challenge the Rosebank proposal for the new oil and gas fields. I just wondered, has that been raised directly by Scottish ministers or by yourself to the UK Government in recent weeks?
So, as I've said in response to Mr Kerr, the decisions around new offshore oil and gas exploration is a decision for the UK Government. We've made very clear our desire to see the UK Government have much stronger climate compatibility checks as part of that process, and we await their decision in that regard.
Just for clarity, is the Scottish Government for or against the Rosebank proposal?
I've already said that it's not our decision. It's not our decision to take. It's for the UK Government to take a decision on new oil and gas exploration. We need to be pragmatic that we cannot switch off oil and gas overnight. That is not going to be possible. However, we're wanting to see the UK Government come forward with stronger climate compatibility checks to ensure that any new oil and gas exploration meets with our net zero ambitions, and we will continue to discuss that with UK ministers going forward, as I'm sure the committee will do.
Monica, I think we've pushed that about as far as we can, and the Cabinet Secretary has given the answer that he's prepared to give. So if I can move on to the next question, which is to ask the Cabinet Secretary, what engagement has the Scottish Government had in REMA, the very snappy title for the Review of Electricity Market Arrangements, Cabinet Secretary?
We are continuing to discuss this with UK ministers. Officials judge that both of the Scottish Government judges that both of the suggestions coming forward, which would be a nodal pricing system or indeed a zonal pricing system, has the potential to disadvantage generators here in Scotland, because Scottish supply often outstrips demand in each area. So we're concerned with those risks for generators, but it's important to acknowledge at the same time that if they are designed well, they may have corresponding benefits for consumers, including business consumers. So we continue to engage with the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero and to understand the implications for Scotland and do what we can to inform their decision-making process.
Okay, so if the gas price remains high, it encourages investment in renewables if the prices are linked, but it disadvantages the consumer. So, i.e., we're paying more for our electricity if it's generated from renewable resources. Are you happy with that?
Well, no. I think we want to see, we clearly want to see a redesign of the electricity market. I think the situation over the last year and a half has demonstrated the absolute need for that redesign. What I'm saying is it's going to be important that the decisions taken by the UK government do not impact negatively the generation capacity that there is here in Scotland, and I think this is absolutely central to your inquiry. Do not inhibit our ability to provide cheap, low-cost, renewable electricity into the network. And so we'll continue to liaise with the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero to ensure, as best as possible, though it's their decision, to ensure as best as possible that does not happen.
I'm not sure the two go hand in hand, but my next question is, there's CCC recommended the establishment of a GB-wide electricity infrastructure delivery group. Do you support that? And what do you think its immediate priorities should be?
Yeah, so I think it's going to be important that we have a network that is resilient and that ensures the demand that is placed upon it from the generation capacity that happens often at the extremities and not as close to consumers is reflective of that and does not discourage generation that is happening away from consumers. So any model for redesigning the grid network is going to be important to acknowledge that fact, again, as I say, to ensure that we do not disadvantage or discourage generation coming, particularly here in Scotland.
Okay, final question on this section from me is the establishment of an electricity networks commissioner has recently happened. Has the Scottish Government made contact and what have they discussed?
Yeah, I haven't made contact myself, but I'll ensure that we check to see what correspondence has been had thus far.
You may want to look to your right. There was nodding going on in the... I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary, I'm trying to help you, but if you don't want to take it, take
absolutely.
It.
No,
I can do. Yes, so at official level, we've had a number of meetings. We sit on the steering group that supports the work of Nick Windsor, the champion. We've been engaged through a number of user groups that his work is also convening and have really strongly put forward the need for grid reform to deliver on Scotland's both generating and consumer ambitions.
Okay, thank you. The next questions come from Fiona.
Thank you. I want to move on to planning. Quite clearly, the responsibility of the Scottish Government. NPF4 has been warmly welcomed by the renewables sector. But beyond NPF4, what work is the Scottish Government doing to aid the deployment of strategic developments? We hear constantly about frustration about length of time for consenting. But how could the consenting regime in Scotland be improved? And what are you actually doing to make sure that actually happens?
So, Deputy Convener is right that the planning legislation is ours and NPF4 is an important part of that. However, the Electricity Act 1989 also comes into play here, where we do not have the full control over all elements of the consenting regime for infrastructure going forward, and that interaction of the 1989 Act means that there can be much slower decision-making processes. For instance, if the local planning authority refuses or objects to a consent, then it has to go to a public inquiry. So NPF4 ensures that we have a very clear pathway, and we're continuing to discuss with Mr. Bowie and other UK government colleagues around how transfer of powers around the 89 Act would allow for us to have a much fuller package of ensuring a smoother but balanced consenting regime.
And if you had those powers, what would you do with them?
it would do exactly as I've just said. We'd be looking to have a much smoother but much more balanced, consenting regime to ensure that we have, interacting with MPF4, a strategic look at where we're going to need that infrastructure, and ensure that we have a prioritisation of that infrastructure going forward, whilst also obviously taking communities with us, which is where the balance needs to be struck.
And speed of decisions? Yeah,
absolutely.
Absolutely what?
Yeah, absolutely. There needs to be a speed of decision. That's the point I was making around having a smoother process to give better certainty to those that are looking to come forward with the applications that we're talking about.
So smoother means quicker?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. You made the point about the need for strategic infrastructure, and in terms of the developers, they want to see the faster construction, commissioning of infrastructure and approvals, whereas there are others who want to see greater care and consideration taken with new transmission lines, you know, maybe perhaps more undergrounding like Denmark has. So do you see the role of the Scottish Government just to streamline and speed up consenting, or can you maybe expand on what I think you were alluding to is how there needs to be engagement with communities to take them with us on this journey? And do you really think communities are aware of the sheer scale of what's going to be required to maximise our electricity infrastructure to take the benefits of both onshore and offshore wind?
Probably not, Deputy Convener. I think you're probably right in that assessment that communities are possibly not aware of the full infrastructure requirements that are going to be. But there's a couple of things here. One is the need to understand that undergrounding in itself is not necessarily the full answer. You know, to underground high voltage cabling requires a significant amount of concrete, and so over a long period of time and over a long distance, which obviously has a huge environmental impacts of their own, and it's also why ensuring that we come forward with a clearer sense of what we're looking to do, for instance, with the likes of hydrogen, of how we can utilise the energy in the locality rather than transmitting all of it, is going to be really important. So obviously taking communities with us is going to be really important, and understanding the scale of the infrastructure is going to be part of that process, and that's something I'm more than happy to take away and look at how we can do more to provide that information going forward.
Thank you,
Commissioner. Cabinet Secretary, sorry, I was taken with an answer to the question there that I think, without putting words into your mouth, that you weren't sure that people across Scotland knew how much extra transmission we'll need across Scotland to meet the demands and the needs of reaching net zero. So do you think it would be helpful? I think SSEN are talking 7 years in advance. SPN, I'm not sure on the duration, but it is a relatively short term thing. Do you think it would be more useful if we came up with a plan to show what would be needed to reach net zero as far as transmission is concerned? Because, I mean, my mailbox is just overloaded at the moment, so perhaps like the national grid, but I mean, I don't think anyone knows what's coming down the track to them, and I wondered, my question to you is, do you think we ought to be honest with them and tell them now?
I don't think it's necessarily about honesty, because I don't think it's you know, necessarily a bad thing, and I don't think we should be viewing it as such, but I do think ensuring people have as much information as possible as to the scale of the infrastructure that's going to be required and the demonstrable benefit that comes off the back of that to us all through a decarbonised network and through us meeting our net zero obligations. So it's something I'm more than happy to take away and look at in more detail.
I think the fear is that one 400 kV line running from Beauly to Denny, for example, are we going to need three more in 5 years' time? Who knows? That's what no one seems to know at the moment, what's going down the track. I think that clarity would be helpful.
So, obviously, you wouldn't expect me to comment on a particular proposal coming forward, but I think it's fair to say that we're going to have significant need for greater infrastructure to ensure that we meet the demand of generation and transmission. And I'll happily take Claire in at this stage to provide some further information.
So there are a number of different publications that sort of set out what the strategic need in the network in GB are going to be. So remembering that Scotland's network is physically and economically integrated with the rest of Great Britain, Northern Ireland not being part of the GB system. So it's the responsibility of the electricity system operators to set out a lot of these things, and they do so through their network options assessment. This sort of sets out where transmission infrastructure is needed and what particular projects there are. Yeah. And then offshore, you have what was called the holistic network design, which was published last July and set out, here's what we think an integrated grid offshore would look like. We're waiting a follow-up exercise to that holistic network design, which will bring in the rest of Scotland. The initial design only accounted for about 10 gigawatts of Scotland. So we've got a follow-up exercise to do the rest of it. And these documents sort of set out, here's what we think the network, or here's what the ESO thinks the network requirement will be, and here's when these need to be live and when these need to be brought on board. So those publications are out there. They're, of course, quite technical documents, but they do exist.
I know, interesting reading as well. So I think the fear of communities is they see one 400 kV line. They want to know if it's two or three more that are coming down the line. And Mark, you want to ask them? Questions on that.
There are particular lessons that were learned on the back of Beauly Denny, which took forever to actually get through. But you know, there were landscape scale mitigations that were put in place. Communities did come forward to see a reduction in the wirescape in surrounding areas. There were substations that were moved, so there were some benefits which flew from the project as well. But I'm just wondering if that's something that is feeding into current thinking, because we have been here before with Beauly Denny and the debate around undergrounding and everything else.
Yes, it will. You know, the lessons from previous applications and previous infrastructure interventions will obviously feed into what comes down the track. And I know I'm confident that. Those that are proposing any future transmission, I have to speak in generalities, those that are proposing any future infrastructure investments will be cognizant of what has gone before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just for clarity, I worked on the Beauly to Denny line and I never heard concrete given as a reason for not undergrounding it. I heard the only reason for not undergrounding it was the cost to the constructor for it. So anyway, moving straight on to Monica Lennon. I think you've got the next questions, Monica.
I think I am unmuted. Thank you, convener.
You are.
Yeah, I wanted to turn to community energy because we know that the Scottish Government wants to, or is aiming to, more than double community owned energy in Scotland by 2030 to 2 gigawatts, and to encourage shared ownership models. I just wondered, Cabinet Secretary, do you think it's enough to encourage shared ownership models, or should a more formal mechanism be implemented?
So I think that we want to be continuing to encourage better community benefit and community shared ownership models. And that is where, you know, your community wealth building and policies come into play, where you can really see for the area that we've just discussed, demonstrable benefit to local communities from a particular infrastructure being put in place. And we'll have all had communities that are neighbouring to renewable or other energy projects looking to see discernible benefits. So I think we need to continue to encourage, but I'd happily take Raggy in at this stage, who's been closer to this over a longer period.
Thank you. So the strategic leadership group that Claire mentioned, which we have with the onshore wind sector, which involves a number of partners, not just from the industry itself, but more broadly, including a representative for community energy, is working up a sector deal, which will contain further action both on the part of government and on the part of industry to encourage greater amounts of community benefit and shared ownership. And we're looking at some of the ways in which we can address some of the barriers to shared ownership, which include things like the mechanisms, the actual rules and regulations of the electricity markets themselves, but also ways in which communities potentially access capital better to be able to invest. So that work is ongoing, and the sector deal will be something we'll produce in the coming by the end of the year.
I'm grateful to Raggy for that update. Just coming back to the Cabinet Secretary, you know, you seem to be keen on the encouraging side of it, which, you know, is fine, along with the community wealth building, but we know that in other countries they do have legislation, for example in Denmark, where the Danish Renewable Energy Act requires all new wind energy projects to be at least 20% owned by local people. So would you be open to looking at similar legislation in Scotland to mandate locally owned stakes in renewable projects?
I would absolutely be open to considering that. I think it's important that we continue to learn from international best practice where that is. You'll have been aware, obviously, the First Minister during the SNP leadership contest was looking to see greater community or state ownership in energy production, and so I know this is something that he and I share an interest in, and I'd absolutely be happy to look at considering what more might be possible going forward along the lines of Monica Lennon's suggestion.
Thank you. And will that include cooperative models of energy schemes?
Absolutely. I don't see why not.
One of the things that I've been wondering is how we can increase capacity building and training for local community energy projects, including at an early stage. In terms of the Community and Renewable Energy Scheme or CARES, do you have any proposals to increase the funding for that or other work to support innovation and improve capacity?
So we'll absolutely look to take any suggestion that anybody has in terms of allocating additional funding. Obviously, we're in a particularly stretched public finance situation. The budget is currently fully allocated, but I'd be more than happy to take a suggestion either from Monica Lennon or indeed the committee if there was a need or a desire for a different intervention going forward.
Thank you. And just final question, because I think it is one of the biggest issues affecting energy and just transition at the moment. I just need to ask again, Cabinet Secretary, on this issue of Rosebank, which is a very live issue, a decision is imminent. Is the Scottish Government in favour or opposed to the Rosebank proposal?
To be fair, I think I've set out my position quite clearly and the government's position quite clearly, and I will rest at the response that I've given earlier.
I'll pass back to you, convener, perhaps because I'm remote today. It's not as clear to me as it is to others in the room, but I'll listen back to this session carefully. Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. Nice try on that one. The next question comes from Fiona. Fiona followed by Mark.
Thank you. Clearly, the UK Energy Bill is going to be incredibly important for everybody in this area, and we want to see progress on that. We've obviously had a number of LCMs, and the committee produced a report wanting to see some change and progress. We welcomed the attendance of Andrew Bowie, the UK Minister, at a previous session, and he'd indicated that there have been ongoing discussions with the UK Government about some of the key amendments that are needed. Can you give us any indication of how that's progressing? Is there active engagement that would enable the consent of the Parliament to help move that bill along, because it is obviously needed for everybody? But there were quite clear concerns that we set out in our report.
So I agree with the Deputy Convener, it's an incredibly important piece of legislation. It's a piece of legislation we support. We are continuing to encourage the UK Government to go further along the lines that I've set out around consenting and other areas, and the areas that the committee has suggested as well. We await further feedback from what Mr Bowie had set out himself a couple of weeks ago to this committee, but hope that that their ambition would go further than what they are currently stating, particularly around consenting, which is, I think, a missed opportunity.
So particularly on we made the point about consent from the Scottish Parliament as opposed mm-hmm. to the consultation aspects were key in our LCM report. I just want to have reassurance that there is active dialogue taking mm-hmm. place with the UK Government yes. currently on the energy bill.
Yes, yeah. Yes, there is.
Mark, I think you've got a follow-up, have you?
Can I just go back to the issue of community benefit from wind farms? When a lot of the wind farms were being developed in the early noughties, the community benefit payments levels were set at quite low. Sometimes it's around £1,000 a megawatt. Some of these wind farms are now going for expansion, for repowering. Do you think there's an opportunity there to be dramatically increasing the amount of money that communities are getting per megawatt from these projects as they seek to expand and become more efficient?
Yes, I think we need to have those discussions. We also need to see greater consistency in where the money, the community development, the community benefit money actually goes, because different areas you see community development trusts, in other areas it goes direct to local authorities to be distributed. I would like to see greater consistency in where those are distributed, and for it to be more demonstrable the benefit that has actually been derived to that local community from having that project neighbouring them. I say that both as a government minister and as a constituency MSP that has quite a substantial onshore wind footprint around my constituency.
Yeah, because the ambition of an extra 12 gigawatts is huge. Mm-hmm. So the potential benefit to communities is huge as well, mm-hmm. regardless of whether that's through ownership or indeed a small amount of money coming through community benefit payment.
Yep. Yeah, no, I absolutely agree with Mr. Ruskell.
Okay.
I think that's all the questions that we've got. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you to your officials. The next step will be for this committee to produce a report to Parliament on its inquiry in the coming weeks. And I would just like to reiterate what I said at the beginning. I think this inquiry is going to produce some interesting evidence, which I believe that the Government and the Parliament should consider carefully as far as our aim in Scotland to reach our net zero targets, because I think it will be crucial to allow us to achieve that. So I can but encourage you, Cabinet Secretary, to give it credence when it comes out. And on that note, I'm going to conclude the public part of our meeting, and we'll now move into private session.